So audio is a huge field, and it's actually arguably the field that really started the interest in deep learning. So we are just going to scratch the very, very surface of audio in this video. And what I really want to show you is that we can take the exact same techniques that we applied to text and image classification and apply it to audio. Now, it's not totally obvious how you would do that, right? I mean, like, audio comes in a really different format than like an image or text, right? I mean, basically, typically we represent it as kind of like a wave or maybe two waves if you have stereo sound. So how do we actually get it in a format where we can process it, and what do we do with it? You know, audio files tend to be big, and it tends to be just complicated to ingest them and handle them. So I'm going to do a very, very small classification example. The idea is we want to classify people saying different specific words. And we're going to see how well we can do that with some really simple Keras techniques. So here's the task. We want to classify sounds, and the sounds are people speaking. And we're going to classify them into what the person is saying. So I found online wave files of various people saying the words bed, happy, and cat. And actually, there were a lot more sets of wave files there. So you can follow a link we'll put in the comments to download more if you want to classify different words. And what we're going to do is we're going to take those wave files, do some transformations on it, and then run various types of neural nets to see how well they classify this data. So, you know, first of all, we do the standard sort of importing libraries like Keras and actually a pre-processed library that I mostly copied from another audio processing Git project. And that does things like transform the wave files into spectrograms. So the next thing that's going to happen is we set the number of buckets in our spectrogram, and we set the length of time that we want to operate over. And then we use a function from this pre-processing library to transform these wave files into something that looks more like a sonic spectrogram. Now, you may not have seen a spectrogram before. You can find lots of apps that do this. In a spectrogram, the x-axis is time, typically, and the y-axis is the frequency of sound, and then the darkness is the amount of energy at that frequency. So in music or in science, you typically get these spectrograms that have sort of even intervals or logarithmic intervals between the frequencies. But actually, when you're processing speech, there's a slightly different transformation that people typically do called MFCC. And so that's the one that I do here. But you can just roughly think of it as buckets of frequencies and kind of buckets of time. So we do that transformation. And then we actually load the training and test set into the familiar xtrain, xtest, ytrain, and ytest values. This is just like, you know, previous videos. Xtrain was often a set of images in previous videos. In this video, it's going to be sets of audio spectrograms, essentially. And xtest is going to be validation data for that. Ytrain is going to be the labels. So 0 corresponds to bed, 1 corresponds to happy, and 2 corresponds to cat. And ytest is the same, but corresponding to the test data. Then we're going to actually reshape our data a little bit. We're going to add a channel element. And this is because typically with audio, you're going to have a left channel and a right channel. Now, in this case, we've actually removed the channel. So there really was only one channel. But this might make the code a little more generalizable to typical audio files that you'll see out there in the wild. And then, you know, before we do anything else, I think it's nice to take a look at the data that we're dealing with the imshow commands. And now that works super well when we're dealing with images, right? You can actually look at the image and see, oh, that's a number 4, or oh, that's a picture of my friend's face. With audio spectrograms, it's a little less clear what's going on, but it's kind of nice to look at anyway. So we could, you know, look at the 100th value of xtrain, and we could see that it seems like it starts off a little quieter and maybe gets a little bit louder. It's a it's a little hard to interpret. We can also print out the corresponding ytrain label and see what that was. And it looks to me like it must be the 0th label, and that would be bed. So this is some kind of distorted spectrogram of somebody saying bed. One more thing before we get started. We have to transform ytrain and ytest into one-hot versions of those. So we talk about this a lot in previous videos, and you can find it there. But essentially, going from this single number to a vector of numbers where the 1 corresponds to the label that we want. And then, you know, as usual, we're going to start with kind of the simplest possible model. And in that case, it's a perceptron. So as usual, we're going to first call flatten to kind of remove all the structure of our data. So the buckets and the length and the channels, we're going to flatten all that out into a single vector. And then we're going to call a dense layer on that, and that's going to be a fully connected layer with, in this case, three different outputs, one corresponding to each word that we're trying to classify. And the typical softmax activation function we use when we're trying to do multi-class classification. We're going to use categorical cross-entropy as usual and the atom optimizer, and we're also going to report on accuracy in this case. All right, so let's fit that model. And you can see that in this case, because the data set's reasonably small, the model runs quite fast. But you know, you can actually see that this very simple linear model gets us around approximately 80% accuracy on the validation data, which is not bad. Okay, so now here's the really cool thing. Because we have our data in such a standard format, we can actually pull from all the different types of models that we've built in earlier videos to make this model better. So the first thing that we can try, and this is something that people really do, we can apply a convolutional network to this. Now, you might argue that maybe we should use a 1D convolution more like text, and you can try that, right? Because maybe you could think of each frequency as a separate channel. But because actually the channels do have meaning, or the frequencies do have meaning, like two frequencies close to each other actually are kind of semantically close, I think a 2D convolution is a reasonable thing also to try. So let's start with that. And you can find in my ML class videos directory, you can actually find examples of all these different classifiers. So let's actually just go into cnn.py and see what happens when we paste in a standard kind of one-level convolutional neural network. So we can just copy this model code right into our notebook here. And now we just have to change the input shape to be buckets, len, and channels. And we can just set this to be a 3x3 convolution. So the dense layer size to 128. We can compile the model in the same way. And then we can fit the model in the exact same way. And again, because it's such a small number of samples, it learns very fast. Let's take a look in the app. And actually, this model is very, very good, right? So this model gets over 90% accuracy, 94% accuracy on our test data just right off the bat, which is really cool. We've actually taken the machinery that we've learned in different domains and applied it to this totally different domain. And the same intuition that we had that convolutions might work better actually turns out to be the case. And you might think, well, if one convolution works well, what about two convolutions? So we can take this same thing that we did before and take a convolution and a pooling and then a second convolution and a pooling. Build this model here, compile it. And actually we could go into a project, we could call this one Perceptron. We could call this guy one convolution. Call this guy two convolutions. So you can see here that our two convolution model is actually slightly better than our one convolution model. Which is awesome. It's like, maybe a 94% accuracy versus a 93% accuracy. But, another thing is pretty glaring, which is that this is the test accuracy. And on the training data, both the one convolution and the two convolution model have 100% accuracy, right? So, it seems like we have an issue with overfitting. And again, we can apply all the intuitions that we learned on text and image data to this problem, right? And so the clear thing to do when you see this, the first thing to try is to add some dropout. So let's put a little bit of dropout in our model. We could put it in the same place that we did before. So we could say model add dropout, maybe drop out a quarter of the stuff and drop out of core the stuff again. Compile the model and run fit. And you see that the two convolutions with dropout is actually learning slower on the training data, but it actually kind of continues to improve. And the same thing happens on the test data, right? So it starts off a little bit worse, but as it runs over time, it gets better and better and better, right? So this dropout actually allows the model to fit the data even a little bit better than without the dropout. So all the things that we expect, all the theory and intuitions that we've learned so far, they apply to audio equally as well as images, which I just think is super cool. Maybe we'll let that run a little bit. Then there's one more thing that you can try, which we did on text, which is we could take LSTMs or GRUs and apply it to audio, right? And this might make sense, especially if we had variable length audio files or much longer audio files. This might make sense. I think actually CNNs probably make a little more sense for these tiny files where they run well. But let's take a peek and see how they do. So we can copy the code from our LSTM video. And so when we copy the code in, you see that actually we get an error, and it's a shape error, and it's because LSTM expects a two-dimensional input, not a three-dimensional input. And so you get this scary error message. In this case, though, remember we actually added the channel variable later. So we could do a more complicated reshape, but I think the simplest thing to do is just undo the reshaping that we did before. And then we can try the LSTM. Now, the LSTM's performance is significantly worse than the convolutions, but that might be because we had a small LSTM. It also could be the fact that our data is actually not very long, and I think LSTMs would matter more as the data gets much longer. So we could spend some time really doing hyperparameter tuning and maybe get this LSTM to the same accuracy as CNNs, but I'll just say for these kind of short audio files, I think CNNs are gonna be faster, train faster and run faster, and probably the better choice. But if we were classifying really long conversations, that's where LSTMs might really shine. I guess my biggest point here, and we can go deeper in subsequent videos on all types of audio processing, but the big point that I want to make is actually the stuff that you're learning is really transferable across domains. I mean, domain expertise has a huge role to play here, but this stuff with CNNs is surprisingly transferable in many different areas, and I think that's just super exciting. So we'll do some more videos on audio. We'll also do some more videos on more complicated architectures. Can't wait to do them.